Hey, good to see you today at New Life.
Amen.
I hope you had a good Thanksgiving.
Amen.
I don't know what you eat for Thanksgiving, but I eat tamales, I eat frijoles. I also eat turkey. All right, so yesterday I'm with my wife and with my daughter, and I don't have to be with them. I get to be with them. Let me say that again. I don't have to be with them. They get to be with me. Because I'm the driver. So I take them to this place to get their nails done. And the ladies there, all of them are Vietnamese. And when I walk in, they look at me and she says, she literally says, "Are you Filipino?" I said, "Do I get a discount if I say I'm Filipino?" So if you're Filipino this morning, you get a discount. Hey, I hope you have your outline. And this morning, I want to share with you what I believe God wants us to remember.
Amen.
What God wants us to remember. Amen. All right? So I pray that you leave this morning remembering these six things that God wants you to remember. Let's pray. Father, this morning, thank you for having spent time with family, with friends on Thursday. Thank you for your goodness with us throughout these 11 months. We're about to start the last month of the year, and you have been very gracious and good with us during 2016. And not only during 2016, but throughout our life, you've been very merciful and gracious. And I pray that as I teach this morning on those things that you want us to remember, that you will help us, Father, not to forget that we've been forgiven because of what your Son Jesus died on Calvary for us. Help us to always, God, acknowledge you and everything that we do, and thank you for all our blessings. Help us, God, to never forget that every good gift and every good blessing comes from heaven above. Help us, God, to count our blessings. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. So today I want to share with you at least six things that I believe God wants us to remember. Amen. Now, all of us have a memory. Sadly, some of us either use our memory when we tend to remember all the bad things that have happened to us. So let me start by saying this. How you choose to remember the significant things in your life, will determine if you live a vibrant, productive, hope-filled life that moves you into the future. But also, what you choose to remember will either cause you to live a life that is full of defeat, full of bitterness, and stuck in the past. There are people that remember only the bad things that happened to them. There are people that remember only the bad things that they did. Therefore, in their memories, they keep rehearsing over and over and over. Therefore, that is the reason many people live defeated, bitter, and they're stuck in the past. So this morning, I want to encourage you to decide to choose the significant memories in your life. Now, the first problem with our memories is this. This is the first problem with our memories. The first problem is that we often forget what we ought to remember. That's the first problem. The things that you should remember, you tend to forget. The things that I should remember, the good things, I often forget. On the flip side, our memory also has a flip side. We also tend to remember what we ought to forget. Let me repeat that. The first problem with our memory is that we forget what we need to remember. On the flip side, we tend to remember what we ought to forget. There's a story of a couple that had been married over 50 years. And once they reached that milestone of 50 years, the lady, they discovered that she had Alzheimer's. And if you have ever dealt with people that develop slowly Alzheimer's, they tend to forget significant days. They tend to forget significant others in their lives. And after about a year or two, she couldn't remember who she was. She couldn't remember her children. She couldn't remember her husband. And sadly, they had to place her in a place where she could be taken care of 24 hours a day. So they put her in a nursery home. And for 2 years consecutively, for 730 days, the husband would come visit his wife. And the doctor counted every day that he came. There was not a day that the husband did not come. So after 2 years, the doctor approached the husband and says, "You know what? I've been keeping count exactly how many days your wife has been in this hospital. And she has been here exactly 2 years. That means she has been here 730 days. And I've counted, and you have not missed one day of coming to see your wife." And the doctor says, "Why do you keep coming knowing that she will never remember you? Why do you keep coming knowing that she will never utter your name?" The husband responded and says, "I keep coming not because she has forgotten my name. I keep coming because I remember her name. I keep coming because I can't forget that she was my first and she was my last love. So while other people might stop coming to church, the reason I come to church is because I cannot forget the love that God has had for me." Where there will be people in your life that will forget what God has done for you, for them, you must not forget what God has done for you. So that's the reason this morning I want to encourage you to remember at least these six things that God wants you to remember. So read with me, please, Psalms 103, verse 2. The Good News Version says this: "Praise the Lord, my soul, and never forget all the good he has done." Read it again. Praise the Lord. Who must we praise? Who is worthy of our praise? And David says, "Praise the Lord, my soul, and never forget all the good things he has done." So in your life, you must praise the Lord, and you must never forget all the good things God has done for you. 1 Samuel chapter 12, verse 24 reads, "Worship him faithfully with your whole heart. Keep in mind the great things he has done among you." Now notice what he says. Not only must we worship the Lord with our heart, but you must keep in mind the great things that he has done among you. The reason Samuel is saying keep in mind is, again, because we tend to forget the good things that God has done for us, and we tend to remember what we need to forget. So this morning, I want to encourage you to remember at least six things that God wants you to remember. Now, there are two things that God wants you to remember about your past. There are two things that God wants you to remember about your present. And there are two things that God wants you to remember, even though we're not in the future, that God wants you to keep in mind these two things about your future. So quickly, let us remember two things that God wants us to remember about the past. Number one, God wants you to remember when you first accepted Jesus in your heart. There's only two of you that have accepted Jesus. There's three of you. God wants you to remember how Jesus has made a difference in your life. There's five of you. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 32, "Don't ever forget." Notice this. It does not only read, "Don't forget." It says, "Don't ever forget those early days when you first learned about Christ." Now, why does the Bible says don't ever forget? Because when you forget what God has done for you, you tend not to keep the same values that you had at once, or you seem not to value what God has done for you. So number one, you must remember when you first accepted Jesus in your life. If you were here last week, we heard David's testimony. And he told us that he was on one side of the spectrum. I believe he never cussed. Maybe the last word that he used was, I'm not going to say it. You know the F word? Forgiveness. Football. Food. That's the F word. One day I said, freaking. And a little girl said, don't say freaking. That's a bad word. She's not here today. Brianna's not here. That's why I said it. But he said that even though he was raised up in a religious home, you know, he never drank. He was the good boy. He still had to understand that grace was available for him. You don't have to have a testimony where God delivered you from drugs or where you killed. I don't know what you did in your life. The truth is that all of us were sinners. And one day Christ came into our life. And the moment you stop remembering what God has done for you, you think it's because of you. So number one, remember when you first accepted Jesus in your life. I don't know about you, but if I ever forget that, it's the end of my story. Now let me tell you what I occasionally do. You don't have to do this. I occasionally do this. I occasionally sit down and write out everything God has done for me. And usually when I do that, I don't know about you, but I begin to tear up, and usually I begin to worship the Lord. Not only do I do that when I need to remember, but there have been times, I'm going to be honest with you, there have been times that I have forgotten where God brought me out. And it is in those times that it has helped me the most to sit down and write what God has done for me. To write when the day Christ came into my life. I don't know specifically the date, but I do know that it was in August 1982. I don't remember if it was August the 1st. I don't remember if it was August the 10th. The date doesn't matter. The date is that day Jesus came into my life 35 years ago, and I should not remember, and you also must remember the first day Jesus came into your life. So I encourage you right now, take a moment, take a second, take 10 seconds, take a minute, and just open up your mouth, either applaud if you want to get up. I don't know. I can't tell you what to do, but you cannot remember. David said, praise the Lord, my soul, never forget what he has done. The Bible says, don't ever forget those early days when you first learned about Jesus. You cannot forget what God has done for you. Now, listen to this. There are times you sit next to someone that seems crazy when they're praising. Really? Look, I'd rather sit with someone that is crazy about their love and their thankfulness for God than being sitting with someone that's big-headed and forgot what God has done for their life. That's the truth. Because after a while, some of you get sophisticated. Oh, if I cry my makeup, forget about your makeup. Remember that first day you cried because Jesus came into your life? Oh, what if I mess up my suit? Forget about your Goodwill suit. Yes. Yeah, I don't know. This brother came into church one day, very nice jacket. I said, man, that's a nice jacket. Where did you get it? He goes, well, all the kids are talking about this mark and this name brand. I said, I got it at GW. And I said, GW, where is that? He goes, Goodwill. Now, you might laugh. But you remember when you used to buy all your clothes at Walmart? I still do, Pastor. Now, I'm not making fun of that. What I'm making fun is, this is the truth. Years ago, my wife, we had a nephew of my wife live with us. Some of you remember him, Antonio Toñito. He lived with us. And I remember when he first came to live with us, he got a job at CC's Pizza. And the first check that he got, we took him to Walmart to buy some pants. And he was happy. After several months, he needed some more clothes. So my wife said, you need to buy some more clothes. So this Saturday, we're going to take you back to Walmart. And he says, Walmart? I don't want to go to Walmart. And my wife says, why is it that you don't want to go to Walmart? He says, I don't want to. Because he started seeing that all his friends in school, because he came to high school, weren't wearing Walmart brand. And now because he had money, we had to take him to the mall to buy a name brand. He forgot that when he first came, he didn't have the clothes that he needed. But when he got his first paycheck, he bought it from Walmart. But now, because he had a little bit more money, he could afford it. And that's good. I'm glad he could afford it. But what I'm trying to convey to you is that all of us tend to forget the goodness that God has been with, the goodness that God has had for us. So never forget the first day Christ came into your life. So sit with someone that shout because they're thankful. Yes. I pray that new life never becomes a funeral home. I pray that we have more fans than the Cowboys fans, the Houston fans. I pray you shout more for Christ than for the Spurs. Yes. See, I've never met Tim Duncan. He's already retired. I'll never meet Kawhi Leonard. If I see Kawhi Leonard, it's going to be because I'm sitting next to Jesus. You know what I'm talking about, right? Way up there. I love the Spurs, and I root for the Spurs. But the Spurs have never done anything for me. You hear what I said? But Christ has done everything for me. So number one, remember when you first accepted Jesus. Number two, God wants you to remember this thing from the past. God wants you to remember the miracles God has done for you. Is there anyone here that remember at least one miracle that God has done for you? All right? Now, if God has done no miracles for you, you don't have to applaud. You don't have to shout. You don't have to thank God. But if God has done at least one miracle for you, come on, take 10 seconds and praise God for the miracle he has done. Hallelujah! Yes! Yes! God, you are good. You've been awesome. Yes! Yes! Thank you, Jesus. God, we cannot forget your miracles. Remember the miracle God has done for you. 1 Chronicles chapter 16 says, remember the miracles he has done. Remember his wonders and remember his decisions. Now, we're in 2016. But I do know that in the 11 months that had transpired, God has done at least one miracle for you. Wow. Yeah. Do you hear what I said? I don't know how old you are. I don't know if you're 14. I don't know if you're 50 like me. But in my life, I have seen miracle after miracle after miracle of God. All right? In my office, I have three things that remember God's miracles. Number one, I have a picture of the small church we used to have years ago. It was 20 by 20. The most that could fit was 60, maybe 70 people. And I have that picture because I remember that God has been great with us. The second thing that I have in my office is I have a bow and arrow. I don't have the time to tell you. You've heard the story of my bow and arrow story. When the hurricane hit, we lost everything. We lost over 55% of the congregation. People left. Over almost 250, almost 270 people left. We were left maybe with 130, 140 people. And that bow and arrow reminds me that in my darkest moment, God had a plan even when the hurricane hit, because that bow and arrow reminds me that the more you stretch the arrow, the farther it's going to go. And that's a reminder to me that 8 years ago, when we thought that they thought that everything was lost, it was simply a setup by God to launch me further, to launch us further. So in my office, I have a bow and arrow to remind me that in 2008, when Hurricane Ike hit, was the best thing that ever happened to New Life. And then I have a picture of our new building to remind me that our future is brighter than my past. All right? So in your life, you must remember the miracles God has done for you. Some of you went through a divorce and you thought that was it, but you're here. Some of you, the doctor told you you were going to die, but you're here. Some of you, you didn't know how you're going to pay for your kids' education, but God provided open doors for you. Some of you moved from a different city, moved from a different country. This morning, I met a couple that came from Santiago, Chile. And I told them, please don't tell Mexicans you're from Chile. Not because we eat Chile, but because Chile beat Mexico 7-0. So Mexicans talk about the past. So I met them this morning. Today was their second Sunday here. And they said, Pastor, we cannot tell you how hard it's been. We left our country, but we didn't have anything in our country. We moved here. And they began to tell me how hard it's been for them, but how grateful they found a life group that has helped them. He said, sadly, there was a people in our own nationality, some Chileans in Houston, at a church. They robbed from us. They stole from us. And when we came to Galveston, this is New Life. We don't know nobody in Galveston. The people in our life group have extended their arms. And we're going to keep coming to our church. And this is what she said. This is what the lady says. She says, honestly, Pastor, we had everything going for us in Chile. But God had to allow for some things to be moved. And now we are grateful for what little we have now. See, because you cannot forget either little or much, God has been good with you. I said, God has been good with you, and God has been good with me. So there are two key things that you must remember from your past. You must remember when you first accepted Jesus, and you must remember the miracles God has done for you. Amen. All right, now what must we remember from our present? Two things that God wants you to remember now in the present. Number one, God wants you to remember that you need to forgive. You need to forgive. Come on, say that word. It's the F word. Forgive.
Forgive.
Come on, say it like you mean it. Forgive.
Forgive.
Tell the F word to someone next to you. Forgive. Now, I hope you don't say the other word, because then you really are going to need forgiveness. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Tell the person on the other side, forgive. Now, if they can't say it, they got a problem with the forgiving. All right, let's read Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive the person who offends you. Remember, say with me, remember. The Lord forgave you, so you must forgive
others.
All right? So if the Lord has forgiven you, you must remember to forgive others in your life also. Now, please listen to me. Please listen to me. As long as you're alive, you're going to be offended. Do you hear what I said? You're going to be offended because you're a woman. You're going to be offended because you're a man. You're going to be offended because you're a teenager. You're going to be offended because you're 50. You're going to be offended because of the color of your skin. Please listen to me. you're going to have to develop a thick skin. Let me repeat that. We have so many sensitive Christians. If there is someone that shall model forgiveness, it should be us. Well, Pastor didn't say hi to me today. They didn't sing my song today. The song was never meant for you. The songs are never meant for me. The song is to give God glory, is to give God worship. It's too loud at New Life. It's too cold. It's too hot. I didn't get a parking space. Arrive early. My kid has never sung. Maybe he doesn't know how to sing. Join my choir. Some people sing in the shower, and that's the only place they should sing. They should never sing on. But this is the truth, guys. As long as you're alive, you're going to be offended. Now, the problem is not if you're going to be offended. The problem is, how are you going to handle the offense? How are you going to handle that offense? Are you going to become bitter, and you're going to keep repeating everything they said to you and everything that did to you? Listen to me, please, please. There is no one in this place that you have not been hurt. People upstairs, people on this side, people here, everyone here, all of us have been defended. All of us, someone let you down. But I'm here to tell you that there is a God that will never let you down. Now, if God has forgiven you, he will never ask you to forgive as much as he has already forgiven you. Do you hear what I said? How many of you God has forgiven you? Now, let me ask you, how much has he forgiven you? ¿Poquito? ¿A little? ¿O mucho? How many of you God has forgiven you mucho? A lot. All right? If God has forgiven you, notice what he says, make allowance. Make allowance. You know what that means? Make allowance. Make room to forgive people in your life. Because when you do not forgive, not only cannot God forgive you, but when you do not forgive, you become bitter, and the blessings of God will always stop in your life. So please, please forgive whoever you need to forgive. Bury that hurt. Bury. Don't rehearse it. Don't say it again. Well, if you only knew what they told me. If you only knew what you did. Okay, they told you. Okay, they did it. But that was 100 years ago. Your husband left you 20 years ago. Your daddy abandoned you. My case, 50 years ago. Get over it. My father abandoned me 50 years ago. How can I still, at my age, still rehearse my rejection? Yes, I was rejected, but there is a God that healed that rejection. Yes, I was abandoned, but there is a God that healed that abandonment. Yes. Remember, you are going to need to forgive. I bet some of you were offended when you were eating turkey. I bet. And I don't like to bet, but I bet. I bet some of you, when someone said, man, leave room for others. You're not the only one that was invited to eat turkey. Would you like some more turkey? No. Are you going to come back next year? No. Are you going to fellowship with us in Christmas? No. Now, I'm making fun of it, but that's the truth. We're so sensitive. That's right. Can I tell you something? We got to mature. We got to grow up. We can't be babies all our lives. Only babies, only kids start rehearsing and saying everything they did to them. He told me, and he told me, and he poked me, and he made fun of me, and he told me this. That's for kids. We're grown-ups. Not only are we grown-ups, we are believers. We're Christians. He forgave us. We can. What did Jesus say? Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. If Jesus was able to forgive when they were being crucified, the next time they crucify you, see, what I'm trying to tell you is that Jesus is able to forgive when they were crucifying him. They will never crucify you. They will never crucify me. In other words, if he was able to forgive, you can also forgive because he has forgiven you. Come on, tell the person next to you, remember to forgive. Remember to forgive. Remember to forgive. The fourth thing that God wants you to remember, and this is what God wants you to remember in the present, God wants you to remember to be generous. Ooh, everybody that was shouting suddenly became quiet. Even, have you noticed when we start talking about money in church, everybody becomes very... Well, we're talking about money. See... There are three things that everybody wants to talk about. There are at least two things. If you're an adult, this is for children, this is for adults. There are two things that every adult wants to talk about, but they don't want to talk about it. What do you mean they want to talk about, but they don't? Everybody wants to talk about sex and money. You said amen. Why didn't you say amen when I was talking about forgiveness and Jesus? Everybody wants to talk about sex and money. Now you become super spiritual. Not me. How do you explain those two kids next to you? How do you explain those babies in the nursery? Now, people believe that in church we should never talk about sex and we should never talk about money and politics. I told this to the congregation. I told on Tuesday, I said, I'm not a politician. I'm a pastor. I'm a preacher. You know where I learned to stay out of politics? You know where I learned to stay out of politics? You notice that I never talk about the Republicans and Democrats? God didn't call me to talk about the Republic. God called me to talk about his kingdom, about Jesus. Now, where I got my message, where I understood that I shouldn't talk about politics is when I read the story that Pinocchio's father took him to see the doctor. Pinocchio's father took him to the... Because Pinocchio's nose grew when he what?
Liar.
When he lied. So here he is. The doctor runs all these exams. And finally gives the diagnosis. And the father says, okay, what must I do, doctor, to keep the nose for my son from growing? And the doctor says, keep him out of politics. So I got it. I don't want my nose to grow. I stay out of politics. But let me go back to sex and money. Sex is not a sin inside a marriage. I wish those of you that are married could help me out. God created sex. The devil didn't create sex. Playboy didn't create sex. Hugh Hefner didn't create sex. Penthouse. Ooh, heard you know all of that, Pastor? I read it on the connection cards. Hugh Hefner didn't create. Sex came out of the mind of God. So let me talk about money. I'm not going to talk about. That's for another topic. We got too many kids here. We got too many teenagers in the house. They already know. So let me talk about money. We must remember to be generous because it is more blessed to give than to receive. The Bible says this in Acts 20:35. Remember the word of the Lord Jesus. It is more blessed to give than to receive. All right? Now, in order for you to give, you have to receive. But it's more blessed to give than to receive. Why must we remember to be generous? Because it makes sense. Come on, tell the person next to you. If you don't understand it, it makes sense. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 9:6. Come on, read it with me. Remember this. Whoever sows little sparingly will reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap. All right. How many want to reap in 2017? Very, very much. Really? Raise your hand if in 2017 you want to reap more than you've ever reaped in the past years of your life. Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up. Are y'all sure? Are y'all positive? All right, get your money out. Get your wallet out. Look, everybody has went down. Now, don't worry. We're not going to pick up an offering. But this is the truth. If you want to reap much, you have to sow much. Right now, whatever you've reaped in 2016 is based on your sowing. If you sow little, you reap little. It makes sense. And then finally, we must be generous because it shows the world what God is like. The world is selfish. The world is about getting, getting, getting. Christianity is about giving, giving, giving. Let me repeat that. Black Friday is getting your money. Really? Yes. Church was never meant to get from you. It's to get to you. And if we give, it's only because he has given to us. So we show the world what God is like. 2 Corinthians 9:13 says, you will be glorifying God through your generous gifts, for your generosity to them will prove what? That you are obedient to the good news of Christ Jesus. All right, so I want to show you this. When you came in, you were supposed to have gotten one of these. You got it?
Yeah.
Everybody got it?
Yeah.
All right, so I want you to see this. Give me those numbers, please, what we gave last year for Building for the Future. This year, 2016, this is what we, every year we give for Building for the Future. So I'm giving you 4 months to prepare what we're going to give from Building for the Future. You notice the amens went down. Everybody said they want to reap more. No. So last year, our goal was to raise $100,000 cash. Cash. Say with me, cash. So remember, we didn't meet our goal. I think we gave close to $76,000. So the next Sunday, I came back and I challenged you. I said, hey, God had impressed me that we were going to raise 100. We're 24,000 short. So in every service, in the morning service, in this service, in the evening service, we raised the other money. And we gave one time $102,458 cash for Building for the Future. All right? If someone is not applauding, it's because they didn't give. But you can give. During the year, we've promised to give an additional almost $100,000. So far, we're behind. We've given $27,350. That means in the past 8 months, since March to November, we've given a total of $129,000 for Building for the Future. All right? So give me the other one. Give me the other one, Millie. Give me the other one. So you have this. On March the 26th, 2017, every year for the past 25 years, we've given to Building for the Future.
Amen.
Now, this is a challenge for every one of you that works.
Yes.
Is to give at least $1,000.
Amen.
Now, some of you have never given $1,000. And some of you, I can't believe Pastor is talking about giving Thank you. All right? Don't raise your hand. But some of you, you're being challenged and you're thinking of giving $1,000.
Yes.
So the next time You hear someone complaining that $1,000 is a lot? I want you to tell them this testimony. I went to my computer this morning because I couldn't remember the date. 2 years ago, September 2nd, 2014, I received an email from a lady that has never attended our church. She's never attended our church. And she writes this. I'm not going to read the whole email, but September the 2nd, 2014, she wrote, "Pastor Gomez, I really don't know where to begin, but I need help and I need advice as a mother. I have watched many of your sermons and Milton's sermons online, and the sermon that I enjoyed the most was the one that your son from Midland did called Helping Help for Hurting Parents. So as I began to watch you online, some of those messages helped me, but this is my predicament." And she goes on to tell me everything that she's going on with her son, 19-year-old kid. She tells me the whole story. So I received this on a Tuesday, and I didn't know what to respond. So on Wednesday, I read it again, and I just prayed for her. And then at the end of her email, she says, "Please call me," and she gives me the number, "if you have time to discuss this." So for 2 days, I said, what do I respond to this lady? I don't know her. I don't know if what she's telling me is real. Because usually when you hear a story, you're only hearing one side of the story. So, but I don't know. And in the email, she says that the reason she found out about New Life is because her son had come once or twice to the youth group. And he had gone with the pen or something that said New Life. So she Googled New Life, and she started to hear the sermons. So 2 days go by, and I said, what do I respond to this lady? So I said to myself, well, just call her. So I called her. It was a Thursday. I still remember it was about 9:30. She answers the phone, and I said, "Ma'am, I'm Pastor Gomez. I did receive your email 2 days ago. I don't have all the answers for you, but I will tell you this, that for God, there is nothing impossible." I don't know if I spoke with her 10 minutes, 15 minutes. All I did at last is that I prayed for her. I said, keep watching the sermons, even though you like my sons more than built is advice, but good give you. Talk about being sensitive, huh? And we hanged up. I have never seen her in my life. I only heard her once. That was Thursday at 10 o'clock in the morning. An hour later, every Thursday from 11 to 12, we have prayer. So the guys at work here, we came into the building and we were praying, four or five of us. And I was kneeling right there where these guys are at. And I suddenly hear the door open. I didn't see no one, but I saw Milton get up and talk to whoever it was. We prayed for an hour, and as we were praying, Milton said, "Oh, Pastor, a lady walked in, and she brought a card, and I put it on top of your desk." So I didn't know what it was. So I go into my office, and when I open it, I immediately saw the name. It was the lady that had sent the email. And she simply said this, "I'm not a member of your church, and you didn't have to return my call. But thank you for reading my email, and thank you for returning my call. And here's a $5,000 check for the children and youth of your church to help kids like my kids." Now, why am I telling you this story? Why am I telling you this story? If a lady that her kid will never use that new building, has never really been in our youth ministry, our children's, was willing, just because of a phone call, willing to give out of her gracious heart $5,000. Do you think $1,000 is too much to give what God has done for your family, for my family, her yet new life? So the next time you hear someone complain, tell him, well, I don't think you've been in church that long, because everybody that's been here has sacrificed something to do what we've done for the glory of God. When that building is built, listen. When that building is built, this is the truth. When that building is built and it's paid for, it'll not be because you gave or you didn't give. It was going to be because God said to build it. Now listen, you don't know this. We had some doctors that came to church and they just left. And they were the top givers. And I was worried. But I went to Costa Rica. And I saw a church in Costa Rica that cost $20 million to build with people that make less money than you. But the same God that we preach in America is the same God that preaching. And this is what the pastor told me. As I was hearing his testimony, and I said, well, pastor, I just left. Just top givers just left. And he said, I'm glad they left. I said, what do you mean I'm glad you left? He says, because God is going to show you it's not with them that you're going to build that. Not that we don't miss them, but God has been faithful to help us build this, and God is going to be faithful to build. Now, let me say this. Some of you weren't here. A couple of months ago, we were having a youth conference. And we invited a pastor from Lake City to preach. And that day, I was translating for him. And he called Milton up and he says, hey, come. I want to pray for the pastors. So my wife and I go down. And we had just come from Costa Rica. We had just come from Costa Rica from seeing that building. And my pastor friend had told me, this week somebody's going to send you money. So I said, okay. The following week, I was going to go to the Philippines. So that Tuesday, 2 days after I get from Costa Rica, a pastor from Lake City comes. And as he's praying for us, he says, oh, you know what? The Lord just told me to give $10,000 to your church. Now, listen. What overwhelmed me was not the $10,000. What overwhelmed me is that 2 days before in Costa Rica, a pastor that had never been, does not know this other pastor, said, this week, they're going to give you money. And then he said this, and out of that money, you said, where's the money? They've already sent $3,000. So on Thursday, on Thanksgiving, the pastor of this church calls me. He's been in the hospital for over a week. He had meningitis. So he calls me, and I said, I wonder why he's calling me. And I've texted him and been in contact. But really, I've been very wise because I don't want to contact him, make him think they were still waiting for the 7,000. You know what I'm talking about? So I'm very careful. I've contacted his associate because I didn't want him to think, well, pastor. So he calls me and said, pastor, how are you doing today? I said, I'm doing. He says, well, I called you for you to encourage me. He says that. I said, man, you freaking crazy, because his preaching was crazy blessing. That's what it was. You freaking crazy blessings when you came. He starts laughing. And he says this, the reason I called you today is because God believes in your dream. And me and my church believe in your, me and my church believe in your dream. See, next week, I want you to send me pictures of your family, of your construction, and I want you to come in January, one Sunday in January. And I'm going to be telling my church for a whole month. And that Sunday, we're going to raise either the 7 or more, because we're going to give to your building because we believe in your dream. Now, can I tell you that I could die tomorrow? I'm not. I could die in 5 years. But that building will be here forever for the children and the youth that will become part of New Life for the glory of God. So remember, be generous. Be generous. All right? So God wants you to remember two things from your past. God wants you to remember two things in the present. In the present, you must forgive. In the present, remember to be generous. Now, there are two things, as I conclude, two things that God wants you to remember for the future. Number one, remember that God will be with you. Let me say that again. Remember, God will be with you. Isaiah chapter 43. When you go through the deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers of difficulties, God says, I will be with you and you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, God says, I will be with you. You will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. So regardless if it's deep waters, God is going to be with you. Regardless if it's rivers of difficulties, God will be with you. It don't matter if it's fires of oppression, God will be with you. See, what I've been through is an indication of where I'm going to. Let me repeat that. The miracles that I've experienced in my life, because you've been through difficulties. It's simply a preparation of what you're headed to, of where you're going. If you fought the giant and you defeated him, you will defeat that other giant in your life. If you overcame a sickness, God is still a healer. He will be with you. When you look back and you didn't know how to pay your college education and you're going through a problem in the future, God will continue to be with you. He will continue to provide. See, most of us, we tend to forget what God has already done. And when we're going through things in the future, because this is the truth, you will go through difficulties in the future. But it don't matter how big, it don't matter what the name of the difficulty, your God will be with you in the deepest of waters, in the darkest oppressions. God will be with you. I wish I could tell you that I've met God, that I knew God, that I've encountered God in the best moments in my life. I wish I could tell you that it's been in the mountain peaks where I've seen the grace, the glory, the presence of God in the greatest manners in my life. It has never been in the peak moments in my life. It has been in the darkest moments. It has been in the difficult moments where everything seemed lost, when I didn't know what to do with my children, with my own self. It's in the darkest moments when God has been with me. What I'm trying to tell me, God has been with me in the good times, and God has been with me in the bad times. God has been with me in the mountain peaks, but God has been with me in the valleys. Not only me, God has been with you. And if God has been with you in the past, God will continue to be with you tomorrow and the next day and the next year. You must remember that. People will abandon you. People will give you their back, but God will always be with you. You have to remember that. And then finally, you must remember that God finishes what He always starts. God is the finisher. God is not a starter. There are so many of us that have started things and we've never completed them. But we have a God that always finishes what He starts. The Bible says in Philippians 1:6, be confident of this, that God who began a good work in you, say with me, in me. Come on, say it, in me. If God has begun something in you, be confident that He who began a good work in you will carry it out unto completion until the day of Christ Jesus. If God started something in you, God is going to finish that work in you. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9. God, who got you started in the spiritual adventure, will never give up on you. Never forget that. Let me repeat that again. God, who got you started in the spiritual adventure, will never give up on you. Never forget that. See, there are people that give up. There are people that throw in the towel, but God never throws in the towel. There are people that gave up on you, but God has never given up on you. He says, never forget that God has never given up. God always finishes. Say with me, God always. Come on, say, God always. God always finishes what He started. Now, let me ask you a question. Is God finished with you? That means you can't die. So stop talking that you're going to die. Is God finished with your children? So don't stop Don't talk negative. Oh, my children, there's no hope. Listen, if there is hope for me, there's hope for your children. My mama never gave up believing that God could change my life. So never give up. When the first pilgrims came to America, you know why they came. They came because they wanted freedom of religion. In England, they were persecuting them. So several hundred families got on a boat called the Mayflower and came to America. And when they came, it was the winter months. Many of them had died on the trajectory coming through the Atlantic. And when they arrived here, they didn't have homes. They didn't have food. They didn't have much provision. And because none of them knew about agriculture, whatever little they sold, they couldn't reap because they didn't know how to prepare the land. They didn't know how to take care of the crop and everything. So the first year for these pilgrims was very difficult. There's a story that is told about the five kernels of corn. And they said that first year, when the winter came, they had so little food that they rationed the portion of corn. And whoever made it alive crossed into the Atlantic, and those that were still alive, even at that winter year, they would get five kernels of corn. That was their ration. That was their portion. That's all they had to eat. Five kernels of corn. So the next year was a different year. They didn't have five kernels of corn. They had a lot of food. So in order for them not to forget how God had been gracious for them, for many years, when the pilgrims ate, on the right side of their table, everyone ate with five kernels of corn to help them remember the day they didn't have food. See, because if you forget where you come from, and you forget your hard times, the good times will spoil your mind and your heart. You will become proudful. And you will think because of you. This morning, we don't have five kernels of corn to remember everything God has done. But I've given you six things that God wants you to remember. Remember your first days when you accepted Jesus. Remember the miracles from God. Remember to forgive as God has forgiven you. Remember to be generous. If I give today, it's only because He gives to me. Remember that God will be with you. Remember that God always finishes what He starts. So God ain't through with you yet. I said, God ain't finished. God ain't through with you yet. God is still on His throne, and God will work with you.